staunch, polite, formal, upright Christians called the Frozen Chosen. Have you ever heard that? I think it usually is in reference to Episcopalians. But today, I think we're all the Frozen Chosen, so I would like to thank you for your bravery in going out to face the cold and start your car on a day where my thermometer said in the car -6 degrees. Today is the first Sunday in Lent, and we welcome you to worship at Aldersgate. We begin our worship service praying. We have joys and concerns that I received during the week. And then this morning, while we're here, if there's any more from children, any prayer requests from children, I will take those from the floor. Any kiddos have anything? They are also frozen. That's okay. That's good. Sure. All right, well then let us pray. Now hear us as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Children to come forward. Here's Esther. Esther was a beautiful woman who lived in Persia. She was one of God's people, the people of Israel. They were called Jews. The king chose Esther to be his new queen. But the king did not know that Esther was Jewish. During this time, the king chose a man named Haman to work for him. Haman disliked the Jews. He found a way to make a law that would get rid of them. God's people were in danger. When Esther found out about the law, she knew she had to talk to the king to save God's people. Queen Esther was afraid. She prayed to God, "Please help me be brave for your people." God helped Esther come up with a plan. Esther was not only beautiful, she was very wise. Esther invited the king to a big dinner. She told him to bring Haman too. At the dinner, Esther turned to the king and said, "Please don't hurt me or my people." "Who wants to hurt you?" the king asked. Esther pointed to Haman. "Haman wants to get rid of the Jews," Esther said. "I am Jewish." The king was angry with Haman and punished him. Then the king wrote a new law to keep God's people safe. And then it says, Esther, God helped Esther with a hard job, and God will help you too. All right? Awesome. What's today? Is it Sunday school today?
Sunday school.
It's in classrooms today. Awesome. You're going to have a great time. And I want to wish you a very happy Valentine's Day as well. Awesome. Yeah, and a great beginning to your school vacation week. It's going to be awesome, isn't it? Yay. Yeah, we'll hold it up. Yeah, there we go. All right. So let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for things that bring our children joy. We thank you for Esther and how beautiful and wise she was as an example for us. And we thank you for Valentine's Day and school vacation. Bless and protect these kids. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, this is from the third chapter of the book of Esther, and it's called Haman's Plot to Destroy the Jews. Well, I was checking, because in some translations, Xerxes is called Ahasuerus, and I wanted to be sure we had the same one here. Same guy, however. Okay, starting with verse 5. When Haman saw that Mordecai would not kneel down or pay him honor, he was enraged. Yet having learned who Mordecai's people were, he scorned the idea of killing only Mordecai. Instead, Haman looked for a way to destroy all Mordecai's people, the Jews, throughout the whole kingdom of Xerxes. In the 12th year of the king Xerxes, in the first month, the month of Nisan, the poor, that is the lot, was cast in the presence of Haman to select a day and a month. And the lot fell on the 12th month, the month of Adar. Then Haman said to King Xerxes, "There's a certain people dispersed among people in all the provinces of your kingdom who keep themselves separate. Their customs are different from those of all other people, and they do not obey the king's laws. It is not in the king's best interest to tolerate them. If it pleases the king, let a decree be issued to destroy them, and I will give 10,000 talents of silver to the king's administrators for the royal treasury. So the king took his signet ring from his finger and gave it to Haman, son of Hammedatha the Agagite, the enemy of the Jews. Keep the money, the king said to Haman, and do with the people as you please. This is the word of the Lord.
Please pray with me. Lord God, once again, we give you thanks for this time and place and the space that you've given us, both physical and spiritual and mental, Lord, just to focus on you. That we ask that through the power of your Spirit that you would touch each parts of our lives, our physical life, our spiritual life, our intellectual life, God. That you would speak into our lives and that you would instruct us and encourage us. I ask that you would help me to think and to speak clearly. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I think my tongue may be a little frozen this morning. The words are not rolling off in the usual way. I want to show you one of the Fisher family's favorite games. This Yahtzee game comes with a little bit of history. I gave it to Sam in the first year that we were married. And, you know, a lot of traditions and behavior patterns are established that first year. And I was so excited to get it for him because I knew that it was a favorite game of his family's. If you ever want to see his mom on fire, like praying to Jesus all the time, play Yahtzee with his mother. It's so much fun. So I wrap up. First of all, I go to Toys R Us. I had to find one because I had no children in sight at that point. I had no idea where toy stores were. This is way before GPS. Went and found the toy store. The last game of Yahtzee on the shelf, it's all damaged and stuff. It was like torn. And I said, can I get a discount? Because this is kind of cruddy. And the guy was like, no. And I was 24. So I was like, okay. So I paid full price for this game. Had to come home and like get a red marker to like cover up the places where it's sort of grungy and tape it all up. And I get it, you know, wrapped up and put on the table for him. He picks it up, still wrapped. Oh, Yahtzee, you got me Yahtzee. Are you kidding me? Like, I love surprising you. I'm so mad. Not that I'm still mad. It's only 15 years ago. But anyway, this Yahtzee game has seen a lot of use in our family. As it turns out, this dovetails wonderfully with so many elements of the sermon. But this sermon has everything to do with playing dice. The story this week from Esther is about the beginning of the Hebrew celebration of Purim, one of the Hebrew holidays. It gives us the setup for why that holiday came into being. And I learned just this time that the word Purim means dice. So I'm holding some Purim here in my hands. Whenever you see an I-M at the end of a word, it's plural. So Pur, one dice, one die, and Purim, dice. So I'm going to ask a couple volunteers here, just that are nearby, to roll some dice. Here, Kevin. You can go tell your mom you played dice in church today. All right. So Carolyn, before you roll that dice, and Lori, and Kevin, what number are you going to roll?
Four.
Kevin's going to roll five, Lori?
I guess I'll roll two.
Two? Okay, go for it. Go ahead. No line.
Two.
You got a two.
One.
One.
Three.
And three. Huh. You didn't know what number you were going to roll. Now, this one through six, it's going to be one of those, but there's really no way of telling, right? Kind of like real life. A lot of things feel like a crapshoot, right? It sounds a little crass to say, but I think another word for dice is crap, right? Isn't that true? Yeah. It was like a crapshoot. So when I'm saying crapshoot today, again, don't go home and tell your mom, I can't believe the pastor said crapshoot. I'm talking about a dice game. Right? It was like a crapshoot that you don't really know, that some things are pretty unpredictable, that they don't follow rules. Right? That's the principle of dice. So with that concept in mind, I want to say that this week was a great week for Albert Einstein. Did anybody hear the news that came out of the physics world this week? Oh my, yes, Dr. Cole. Yeah, wow, there was like front page news from physicists. This stuff is so cool. I know you're going to love it as much as me. Noah, put down the lights and we're going to look at a picture. Oh my gosh. A huge thing happened in science this week. This is stars, and hopefully we'll be able to see a little better. Do I have my laser pointer? Is there a little remote there? Yeah. Oh good, I've always wanted to do this. It's like giving a presentation. Laser pointer. Laser, there it is. See this? Right here in the middle, there's one circle here, and there's another circle there. You see that?
Uh-huh.
One and the other. These are two black holes. 1.3 billion light years away from here, two black holes that have been circling around each other. You can kind of see the sort of circly orbiting, you know, trails of that happening. Have been circling and circling and circling around each other. One black hole, actually each black hole, let's say, for simplicity's sake, about 30 times the mass of our sun, the volume of our sun. Huge black holes. Circling around. And 1.3 billion years ago, they collapsed into each other. And get this, wait for mind blown. You would think that two black holes, each weighing 30 suns each, combined would weigh how many suns? Tell me.
56.
60, good, I'm glad to see we're on our game. Should weigh 60 suns worth? No, 57 suns. Because three suns of energy were released in this explosion that was so huge, nothing is believed to be bigger except for maybe the Big Bang, so huge that it sent out waves all across the universe at the speed of light and just hit us, our planet, this year. It happened 1.3 billion years ago, and the waves from that explosion just hit us this year. Do you remember, you can put the lights back on, do you remember what you were doing on September 14th, anybody? September 14th last year? I hope you don't, because it probably means it was a bad day. I don't remember, or maybe your birthday. I had to go look on my calendar.
It was a Sunday, we were here.
It was a Monday, yes.
I went back. I remember what I was doing.
Yes, I looked on my calendar. Do you remember? Kind of? No, not September. But so I looked at my calendar, I don't even remember. I looked at what I did on September 14th, and it still didn't ring a bell. That's a little scary. But September 13th, we were in here, it was raining, we had a bounce house. Oh, yeah, okay. You remember having the bouncy house inside? That was September 13th. We all went to bed September 13th, and just before 5 a.m., these waves from the explosion hit the Earth. And do you know that our Earth changed size for a fraction of a second? They did. Because these waves that hit us were not little tiny light waves. They were not like radio waves, which are about this big. Radio waves can be even like this big. They were waves that from crest to crest, 3,000 miles long. These were gravitational waves, something that Einstein predicted 100 years ago and had never been demonstrated until last fall. I mean, so exciting. So Einstein predicted the E equals MC squared equation, general relativity. He predicted that, and we finally proved it. The scientists reported it this week. Absolutely awesome. Gravitational waves are so huge and so powerful, they actually warp matter like this. And the size of the Earth changed for just a fraction of a second. Like one atom, like it changed really, like I was glad I was asleep because it was gonna hurt. No, it didn't hurt. It was just a tiny thing. Absolutely mind-blowing stuff. So good for Albert Einstein, good that he predicted that. The reason that I'm talking about all this is because Albert Einstein actually has one of my favorite quotes about God that doesn't come from the Bible. Albert Einstein said that God does not play dice. Life is not a crapshoot. Physics is not a crapshoot. He said it because he was hearing some other theories. He was talking about rules for governing really large things. There were other physicists talking about rules for governing really tiny things, and he didn't like what they were saying. He's like, what you're saying is that everything's a crapshoot. You can't predict it. No, God creates things with rules, with order. And you're telling me it's just random? I don't have time for that. God does not play dice, said Einstein. So as it would happen, Einstein and dice and Esther all come together this week because of the way God lines things up. There is a dice game that does not have to do with physics. in this book, but has to do with the fate of the Hebrew people in Persia. There is a roll of the dice that we just read about that says that the Hebrew people in the kingdom of Persia are going to be exterminated on a certain date. This is why it happened. Some of us remember from last week, we heard from a woman named Ruthie. I did the sermon with the thing over my head. At the time, about 500 years before Jesus, the Jewish people had been exiled from Jerusalem. They were living in Babylon. The regime changed. They were able to come back to Jerusalem and rebuild the temple. You remember the story from last week, rebuilding the temple. So some of the Jewish exiles came back to Jerusalem to do that. Some of the Jewish people stayed. Now they're living in Persia under King Xerxes. King Xerxes, who is so extravagant, so powerful, he's considered to be a god by the people around him. This guy is so wild that he threw a party that lasted 180 days for all the people, the high-ranking people. 180 days. This guy was violent, he was vicious, he was impetuous, and he ruled with total power. When people decided to stay and not return to Jerusalem under King Xerxes, they lived as a discriminated minority. They didn't want people to know that they were Jewish, because to be Jewish in that kind of violent, very extravagant time was a risky thing. So, some of King Xerxes' administrators say, you are a god and you are a king, and we think that there needs to be a new rule. And what will happen is that when people pass your palace, they need to bow down to you because you are God. And everybody says, that sounds good to me, because he's so powerful, he's so rich. Obviously, he is God. But there's a few people, those Hebrew people, who find this offensive. I'm not going to bow down to a human being. And they don't do it. They get noticed. And so the administration says, that's disrespectful, and we won't tolerate this. We want to destroy the whole Hebrew people. And how do we determine their destruction? We're going to roll the dice, the Purim. We're going to roll the dice. And the date that the dice tell us will be the date that all the Jewish people are destroyed. So they roll the dice, and the date is set for about 11 months into the future. Now, can you imagine, as a person who has lived as a closeted Jewish person in the Persian Empire at that time, receiving the news that your entire people now are going to be defenseless on, let's say, next January 25th, all right? That anybody in the Persian Empire has free reign to kill you next January 25th. To know that there's no way to run from this. The Persian Empire is as big as the world as far as you're concerned. There's nowhere to go. And the fact that this plan was hatched in the government and nobody stood up and said no means that you have no allies, you have no recourse, you have no army, you have no king of your own to help you. How are you going to get, this absolutely shocking, devastating, horrifying news to receive. But the amazing thing about this story is that this news did not surprise God at all. And in fact, God had been working for months and years behind the scenes to prepare things to be able to go well for God's people. So let's back up just a little bit. Remember that 180-day banquet that I talked about, 180-day party that King Xerxes had? It ends up with 7 days of feasting, absolute unlimited food, absolute unlimited wine, awesome. Everybody's having a great time. All the men are over here with King Xerxes and the men's banquet. All the women are over here with Queen Vashti, the most beautiful woman in the land, having a women's banquet. So after 7 days of food and drinking, you can just imagine, right, what things must be like. And King Xerxes says, I would like to show off how awesome I am by parading my wife around, and there's various opinions about in what state of dress she would be, parading my wife around in front of the men. And so he summons Queen Vashti. He says, wear your crown. Doesn't mention anything else. Wear your crown and come here and walk around the banquet so that all these men can be impressed with my beautiful wife. And guess what Vashti says to the god king Xerxes? You want to say no to him? She says no. She says no. What are the odds that there would be a woman who would be willing to stand up to this guy? But she had enough, and she said, no, I will not parade around probably only with my crown on in front of a bunch of men so that you can look big. I'm not going to do it. And she refuses him.
Xerxes says, I can't take that. That's gonna, that not only does that make me look bad, this does not bode well as an example for all the women of Persia. Like, right? Like, women are going to start thinking they can make up their own minds. That is not okay. And so what they do is they don't kill Vashti, but they take her crown. She's no longer queen, and she is shunned. She never sees Xerxes again. So now Xerxes needs to find a new queen. All right, so how are we going to do this? Let's call it The Bachelor. It's just like The Bachelor on TV. Wow, how times have changed. So we're going to have a man here who has all the decision-making power, and we're going to do a casting call for all the beautiful women of the land. And so the women are all brought in. Let's say there's about 50 of them. There's like a talent search, a beauty search. Women all coming in. One of them happens to be of this tiny minority group, the Hebrew people. She doesn't reveal it because that's risky. She's just extremely beautiful. So in she comes. And ladies, how about this? And men too, actually, men would like this. 6 months of beauty treatment. 6 months of spa, like yoga and Pilates and facials, and this doesn't sound too bad, right? Like herbal teas and like lovely things, hair treatments. They get this for 6 months, all 50 of them, to get them in the right shape to go meet King Xerxes. And Esther, this Hebrew woman, immediately sets herself apart in a group of 50. I mean, if you want to win a contest among 50 people, you know the odds are against you, right? But she goes right up to the front of the class. She gets like prime seat. And so when all the ladies are going to be brought into King Xerxes so he can choose and give the rose ceremony and do that whole thing, right? He actually doesn't go through any of that. He looks at Esther and he says, you're it. You're gorgeous, right? You're going to be queen. What are the odds of that? This Hebrew woman, this despised minority far away from King Xerxes' palace, goes to being queen of the kingdom of Persia. She still doesn't tell him that she's a Hebrew. She keeps that to herself, might never have told him. Except then, those dice were rolled, and the edict was decreed that all the Hebrew people were going to be killed on January 25th. And it was at that time that she realized that perhaps all those random coincidences that had lined up in such crazy ways to get her in the palace with the crown on, maybe weren't random at all. And she's very wise, and she thinks very carefully. She speaks to Mordecai. We heard about Mordecai in the scripture lesson, her uncle, about a good strategy to do this. And she very skillfully goes in to King Xerxes and asks him to spare her people. Now what he does is he ends up saying, well, okay, how about on January 25th, the Jews can fight back, right? It won't be a completely unfair fight. They can fight back and defend themselves. That's the way they change that so he doesn't look foolish or anything. And they do fight back, by the way, and they do very well. And so here, God has provided a way for the Hebrew people. God was orchestrating that months and years before the idea to roll those dice and set that day even happened. And so I want you to take some comfort, and I want me to take some comfort right now in the fact that sometimes things really do seem like a crapshoot, and they do seem completely random, and we get sideswiped and blindsided by things that just send us reeling, maybe not a death notice like the Hebrew people at that time, but by some terrible news or some very upsetting thing that has just happened. What? What are we going to do now? What's going on? I don't know what the next step is. And we are caught by surprise. Just like when you rolled those dice, you were caught by surprise. But the word is that God is never caught by surprise. God knew about this 1.3 billion years ago. And the way it started coming, it just came into effect here. God's known what's going to happen tomorrow since the beginning of time. And so even though we are surprised and we feel off balance and we don't know what the next step is, God has already been moving and working to orchestrate the ways that God might provide for his people. I'm just going to use Kaio as an example, if you don't mind, but when I got your letter, right? Kaio gave us a 6-week notice a few weeks ago, a number of weeks ago,
And I remember I got that, it was after church, and I came to my desk, and there's an envelope sitting on my desk, and there's a post-it note on there, and it says, like, P.S., I'm sorry, I couldn't quite do this in person, I was too upset or something. And I was like, I can't say it in church. Darn. I was like, oh, knew what it was, and I opened it up, and I was like, oh, that surprising news, not the news we wanted. But then right away, you think this is a surprise to God? You think God didn't know about this a long time ago? You think Kaya's wonderful new job that you've got provision for you right now, and though you're having a lot of changes in your life, musically, right? This is God's provision for you and your family for the years to come. And like, I don't love the thought of not having this wonderful, talented man here. But I do believe that God knew about it a long time ago, and that maybe 25 years or maybe 23 years ago, a nice baby boy was born, and that we'd come here someday, you know, with a musical guest. We met one this week, so keep praying. God knew about it. And it calmed me down. And it made me say, okay, God, I trust you that you've already been moving. You've already been lining these things up. And please help me to just rest in that and take comfort in that. And just to have my eyes open so that I can discern with you, God, as to what the next steps are. And so that's my prayer for you. Whatever it is that you're like, oh, wow, what are we going to do? Will you spend some time in prayer and just say, God, I know this doesn't surprise you. I know this is not just a random roll of dice for you. That you have this, that you know this. Will you please help me see with your eyes so that I can see what you've been planning here all along? And then we can rest. Einstein said that God doesn't play dice. God doesn't play dice. Maybe even better than that to say is that there is a person who rolls the dice, but God is the one who allows them to fall the way they do. And God's the one who knows how the dice are going to fall. And so instead of feeling terrified by sudden, strange, upsetting news, let us spend time with her and say to God, this does not surprise you, Lord. Please help me understand what you're already doing in this situation. Incidentally, now that we know about gravitational waves, we have something we can blame when we drop things. I've decided this because yesterday at the breakfast, there were a number of us. Marilyn kindly joined me in dropping things all over the floor. And so now Marilyn can just say, the gravitational waves, that's what it is. Absolutely, we have a new excuse. It's time for our offering. Let us pray. Lord God, we are humbled and amazed at your universe that you have ordered so exquisitely. We're amazed by what scientists find out, and we're amazed by a story like Esther's, where you are providing so far in advance for exactly what we need for your people and your plan. God, please help us to trust you with these things, and please accept this offering as our grateful response to all that you do. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. It is time for announcements, and I have an announcement from Pastor Johnson. I don't want to make you guys get up, but Pastor Johnson wanted to recognize Nicole and Joey and Dee, who is
in Sunday school
right now. He gave each of them a certificate of appreciation for the work that they did last Sunday afternoon at the Valentine Youth Jam. Each of you received a certificate to say thank you for your help with music, and it was music, right?
They all performed
yesterday in the Youth Jam. So he appreciates you, and so congratulations. Give him a hand. I'll give you those after church. A couple of announcements. The Daniel Plan that Lori Downs is facilitating is going to be starting tomorrow evening at 7 p.m. And so very excited for you, Lori, and we pray God's blessings over the success of that. Also, as you came in this morning, there was a table that was filling up with fruit donations for the food pantry. Each week during Lent, our goal is to collect 40 items in a specific theme. So I don't know if we made it today. Did you count, Suzanne? 14! We have to come back with a vengeance then for next week. My goodness, people. I know everybody's cans of fruit are sitting on their counter, the people who didn't get their car started. So next week, it's in your bulletin what we'll be collecting for next week, personal care items. These are items that cannot be purchased with food stamps. So please just bring a couple things and stick it on the table, and hopefully we will get to our goal of 40 items a week. For celebration and thanks, we have a celebration from Kevin to the breakfast crew for a fantastic breakfast setup and breakdown serving 105 people. For the breakfast crew, let's give them a hand. All right. Very good. Yes, Don Marie, go ahead.
I just have such a thank you. From thousands of miles away, I received all the prayers from this church through a stranger who approached me and said, "Do you go to Aldersgate in El Salvador? Do you go to Aldersgate in North Reading?" And I said, "Boy, how would you know that? I had never met this woman." She said her sister had visited this church the Sunday prior, and she heard a squeaky little voice who was praying for her mom in El Salvador. I'm so emotional. Just to get that prayer from thousands of miles away, this church is so prayerful. And it meant the world to me to know that anybody was praying. So thank you.
So, are you saying that there was someone here two weeks ago or last week who heard your prayer request for you? And her sister was in El Salvador and walked up to you?
Yes. Right? Wow.
I know, it's like two black holes in the waves and the things. You know what I mean?
I was so moved. I literally cried. I thought, "Oh my goodness, from thousands of miles away."
That's awesome.
How are you?
All right, well, go God. That was actually a prayer thanks to God, wasn't it? All right, well, please stand then for the benediction. May the God who has ordered this universe and all things in such amazing ways and according to God's plan be with us until we meet again. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.